Human rituals. A Heart of Jesus procession in Tyrol, Austria. Every year since 1796, on one of their most important holidays at the time of the summer solstice, the people of Tyrol rededicate their land to the Heart of Jesus to commemorate the Tyrolean fight for independence. Fight! Traditional customs and religious rituals are not only part of Alpine folklore. Whether it be the Schuhplattler in the Reigen or Rondell dances in Bavaria, or keeping ancient arts and crafts alive at various local medieval festivals. The globalization of our modern world and protracted periods of unrest have driven a revival of awareness and appreciation of local identity and the value of cultural traditions. In many countries, customs passed down through the generations have never stopped having a major influence on the everyday lives of local peoples. Commonly held customs and rituals meld the inhabitants of a region together. For scientists, they represent an important social activity of local communities. Under the influence of Christianity, wild and even occult rituals have turned into customs that promote peace. One example is this Thanksgiving celebration to mark the cattle being herded down from the alpine meadows at the end of the summer. Besides getting together for the regular recurring events, folks tend to gather primarily for rites of passage, such as weddings, births, or funerals. But let's take a broader look at the world and be amazed at the similarities of the customs of peoples in vastly different regions of the earth. The first leg of our journey takes us to Norway, the land of fjords and mountains. Historical Scandinavian customs are still very much alive here. In the 18th century, the warlike Vikings occupied large areas of the country and laid the foundation of the folklore of today. In no other Scandinavian country is the preoccupation with commemorating the past as strong as it is in Norway. Shipbuilding in the old Viking style is one clear expression of that fact. But traditional folk dances and cultic rituals are also preserved and practiced. The locals are happy to share the often not so rosy stories of the past with visitors to historic villages. Today, popular tourist attractions like the city of Bergen in the north of Norway, for example, stand as reminders of the days when German traders came to this region known for its abundance of fish. Dried codfish and fish oil were traded for grain and other goods. Bergen became a member of the Hanseatic Trade Association in the 14th century, and the wild Vikings were transformed into cultured citizens. But to this day, the Norwegians still express their unique cultural identity in the historical folk dances performed in traditional garb to the music of the Hardanger fiddle. Local cuisine also plays an important role in human traditions. For the Norwegian, that means the fish of the sea, primarily herring, cod, monkfish, or crabs. The Sami people are indigenous to the Arctic regions of the country. They live from raising reindeer. Their traditions are marked by a simple lifestyle, and they still proudly wear their traditional dress as their everyday clothing. But don't let their simple lifestyle fool you. They are sharp business people. They have developed the tasty reindeer meat into a major Norwegian export product. Yet it is still dried in the Arctic air for the most part, as has been their tradition for centuries. Even before the first trade relationships to the already Christianized Northern European regions developed, a phase of transition from the heathen customs of the Vikings to Christianity had begun. It took a good 200 years before the first stave churches were built. They stood as testimony to the fact that Christianity had finally taken root in the far north. Interestingly enough, heathen symbols are also to be found decorating the stave churches, creatures out of ancient Nordic myths, for example, even though the Christian faith was never combined with heathen beliefs in Norway. There was probably a good Christian interpretation for the symbols. We can go even farther back in time as we look at the development of customs and traditions in the land of Yemen. Archaeological evidence reveals that an advanced civilization existed already more than 3,000 years ago in this land, which is today plagued by terrorism. While people in Europe were still living in primitive huts, here, people were living in apartments in multi-story buildings. In the 7th century before Christ, the Prophet Muhammad introduced Islam to the Arabian world. With about 1.6 billion followers, this religion is the second largest in the world after Christianity. In everyday life, even very profane traditions can play an important role, such as the game of dominoes, for example, or even the method of building houses out of clay, which is still practiced to this day. Very early on, methods of making plaster were discovered, and it became clear that coating the clay with plaster served to protect houses and palaces from the effects of the weather. Although coffee did not originate in Yemen, this is the region credited with the development of our modern-day coffee-drinking culture. Experts still consider coffee from Yemen to be among the best in the world. Growing, harvesting, and processing coffee under difficult conditions in mountainous regions using the traditional methods of times past is no marketing ploy, but simply part of day-to-day life and tradition. And so, as in most modern civilized society in the Western world, offering a cup of coffee at business meetings or a private visit is a typical welcoming gesture on the part of the host. In Yemen, it is also traditional for a man of the world to carry one important clothing accessory with him at all times, a curved dagger, a chambia. Here it is being worn at a wedding celebration. Over the past decades, carrying a Kalashnikov automatic rifle over the shoulder has been added to the traditional arsenal. The ancient Yemenite tribal culture, which is very much alive and well today, is to blame for this practice. Social life in Yemen is influenced by numerous clans, which don't necessarily get along with one another. There are recognizable similarities with Alpine cultures in this aspect as well. The inhabitants of the various mountain valleys place great value on their unique characteristics and social norms. But, at least in Europe, they aren't killing each other. In Yemen, as in other Arabian countries, the living areas of men and women are strictly segregated. Even at weddings, the sexes do not celebrate together. While the men are performing their dances and feasting together, the bride is being painted with henna and draped in the most elegant of materials. The man has to pay for everything. Traditionally, he is responsible for providing food for the family and taking care of everything having to do with public life and business. But for that, the woman is the ruler and administrator of the household. In Islamic society, that gives her a quiet authority which is not to be underestimated. The men's dances serve primarily to strengthen social bonds. Communal celebration melds the clan members closer together. It is only this unity that assures the important influence a clan has on the political level. Experts say that the problems the country is facing today are the result of the neglect and disregard, primarily by the British, of local traditions that have developed over thousands of years. The attempt by the occupying allies to force a Western-style democratic government on the country was finally abandoned in 1967. Since that time, nearly all efforts to unify the numerous tribes in North and South Yemen have failed. Thank you. From Arabia in Western Africa to Namibia. Here as well, ancient traditions have outlived the influence of outside occupation, in this case by the former colonial power of Germany. Whether on the Atlantic coast, where the desert extends right down to the ocean, or farther inland, for today's tourists from all over the world, Namibia is sort of the Disneyland of African natural environment and culture. Some tribes retain aspects of their original lifestyle just for the sake of the tourists. This form of presentation is reminiscent of folklore performances found in many vacation locations throughout the world, but they often only reflect the reality of the customs and traditions to an extent. The Himba people, a tribe of half-nomad shepherds, still live as they always have for the most part, living from raising sheep and goats. Their social structure is archaic and pretty unfair. The men limit their work to herding and breeding the animals, while the women carry responsibility to build the huts, take care of the home, and do all other work there might be to do. Their lives are dominated by traditions passed down through the generations in all other areas as well. Among those traditions is the right of a man to have multiple wives. The social standing of a woman is portrayed in her dress, jewelry, and hair decoration. Until reaching puberty, they wear long braids decorated with pearls and a waistband that signals that they are off limits to men. When they marry, they shorten their hair and bind it up. By the age of about 13, they may have already been promised in marriage. In a well-defined ceremony, the evil spirits are cast out, and one of the cows is sacrificed for the celebration feast according to traditional custom by slitting its throat. Inside the hut, the bride adorns her festive jewelry. The leather head covering, the ekori, plays an important role. It is passed down from the bride's mother to her daughter. In the meantime, the meat is getting done in the cooking pots, and everyone is waiting for the symbolic stealing of the bride from the hut. She covers her face with the folds of the leather head covering for that event. In times past, the bride really was stolen from her family, and that resulted in intense battles between the clans. Today, it has become a ceremonial act which proceeds peacefully and very slowly. Having arrived at the bridegroom's hut, she is received by his relatives. Together they eat the beef as a rare delicacy, and then cream the bride with butterfat from the future husband's cows. The bride is showered with special treatment. She should be assured that she has come into a good family. A wild night of celebration, during which both men and women display their physical beauty through traditional dance, has preceded the wedding. The African version of the bachelor party.
Oh.
Kenya, is located in East Africa. Here, in the Serengeti and Masai Mara, live the Masai people. This proud polygamous herdsman and warrior people believe in a single god, Ngai, who is a spirit being. They consider all other tribes who do not believe in their god to be subservient to them. Their tribal laws are the expression of the will of this god. When a Masai couple gets married, several cattle are given to the bride's family as a dowry. It takes a man until the second half of his lifetime to accumulate the wealth needed to provide a secure home. So the age difference between bride and groom is often quite large, to the chagrin of the young bride. The heads of both the bride and the groom are shaved for the wedding. This is necessary in order to rub their heads in with beef tallow and red earth as part of their festive dress. The bride is adorned with many amulets. They are meant to protect her from illness and other mishaps. Complicated rules forbidding marriage among close relatives protect the tribe from incest. It seems that this primitive people was familiar with the danger of incest resulting in the birth of handicapped children thousands of years before modern science came along. Wedding guests include the bridal couple's relatives and the members of the communities the parents of the couple live in. The ceremony begins with the bride moving into the groom's hut. She takes all of her personal possessions with her. From the moment she leaves her parents' hut, she's not allowed to look back. This departure is never a joyful moment for the bride, and tears often flow. Masai parents provide their children with a loving and secure family environment. A great feast begins with the bride's arrival in the groom's hut. Either a goat, a sheep, or a cow is slaughtered for the occasion. The honey of wild bees is also among the delicacies of the feast. The slaughter and cleaning of the animal is carried out as a ceremonial sacrifice. The thickened blood and inner organs are among the favorite delicacies being served at the fireplace in the hut. In some Masai tribes, it can get a bit rough at times for the bride. Close relatives and also the stepmother taunt and tease her, giving her the doubtful enjoyment of pretended enmity. This is meant to prepare her for possible difficulties in the marriage. Complaining about not enough food being prepared or poor cooking are the most popular methods the women use to tease the poor bride. As with most primitive people on Earth, social unity is expressed in communal songs and dances. The relatives of the bridal couple find their way together without many words. From East Africa, we move to the top of the world, the Himalayas in Nepal. Fearsome landing approaches, like here in Nukla, are just as much part of daily life as the fear of natural disasters, like the terrible earthquake of 2015. The people here balance their dangerous and difficult day-to-day existence with their religion. About 80% of the population is Hindu, and about 15% is Buddhist. Whether tour guide or mountain farmer, very few view death in the same way a Christian would, for example. Hindus and Buddhists see life and death as a natural, unending cycle. Religious symbols like the Buddhist prayer flags are found even on the dizzying heights in the shadow of Mount Everest. Perhaps because one is closer to heaven here, and closer to the enlightenment which, according to Buddhist teaching, will free the human spirit from the unending suffering of the cycle of continual reincarnation. That leaves an impression on visitors from more highly developed societies, many of whom believe that physical existence ends with death. Death means that the soul goes to a spiritual place of existence and does not return in another life form. Since the great earthquake of 2015, it seems to make sense to orient oneself to the conservative foundation of the Buddhist teaching. There are basic facts of life, to recognize and accept them insofar as they cannot be influenced by our own behavior, is the first step to overcoming an existence marked by suffering. Kathmandu is characterized by a strong mixture of Hinduism and Buddhism. The city is virtually overgrown with temples and holy shrines honoring the gods. Unfortunately, to the critical observer, it is also clear that an oppressive materialistic motivation has taken a firm hold. The religiosity which is so important to so many people has fallen prey to an alarming extent to tourism marketing. Changing that, however, would cut off the flow of income provided by visitors from all over the world, funds that this very poor country desperately needs. Thus, true faith mixes with the necessary marketing of worthless knickknacks, and vacationers stand amazed at the majestic temples without really understanding the two major religions with their complicated rules and rituals. The god of life is honored in the temple of Shiva. The temple complex stands on the banks of the holy river Baghmati. While the temple itself is reserved for Hindus only, the temple area is open to all visitors. Inside the temple complex, cremation stations for the dead are located on the banks of the Baghmati. To be cremated here has a special meaning for the faithful. This public mourning for the dead doesn't seem to bother anyone else. Before the corpse, wrapped in a yellow cloth, is set on fire, it is sprinkled with water from the holy river. Then the remains are covered with straw, or in the case of the more wealthy, with sandalwood. After about 4 hours, the cremation is complete and the ashes are scattered on the waters of the Baghmati. To the visitor, this public display may seem irreverent, perhaps partly due to the fact that the cremations have been degraded to a tourist attraction in the meantime. But against the background of reincarnation, death simply has a different meaning for Hindus and Buddhists than for Christians, for example. For them, the Son of God arose from the dead and walked among us for only a short time before being taken up to heaven. Until the great earthquake of 2015, numerous religious sites and temples defined the landscape in the Kathmandu Valley, as everywhere else in Nepal, including in Patin. Buddhism is the dominant religion here, and the city was originally laid out according to the Buddhist wheel of justification. A total of 1,200 Buddhist monuments decorate the city. Many of them were destroyed by the earthquake. It will take a very long time to rebuild them all. Our journey takes us further eastward. The next goal is the Indonesian island of Bali, the only region outside of India, Nepal, and Mauritius with a predominantly Hindu population. Bali is also called the Island of 10,000 Temples. Every Hindu clan, area, or village has three temples: the Temple of Origin, the Temple of the Great Assembly, and the Temple of Death. Since Hinduism was introduced to Bali in the 8th and 9th centuries, religious festivals and rituals accompany the inhabitants nearly every step of their lives. One of the best-known temple complexes is Pura Tanah Laut. This land in the midst of the ocean, as the name translates, was founded by a Shiva priest from Java. It was built to protect the inhabitants from plagues and sickness. The goddess of the sea, Batara, seems to be impressed to this day. Bali was spared from the destructive tsunami of December 2004. That strengthened the faith of the local people. Their prayers and offering to the gods at the temples, from the foot of the holy mountain to the temple of the swimming garden and all other holy sites, are meant to appease the five elements: heaven, wind and clouds, fire, water, and the earth. The Ulun Danu Temple on Lake Aratan was built in honor of the water goddess Devi Danu. Under the protection of the pagodas, which represent mountains, more goes on than just prayer. Visitors are introduced to Hindu wisdom through plays performed in the Wayang Shadow Theater using stick figures to act out the parts. It is perhaps not so important for the foreign visitor to understand the depths of Hinduism. It is sufficient to have the courage to be open to the ever-present spirituality in one of the several temples to find a bit of rest, not only for the body, but also for the soul. Staying in the Asian region, we journey on to the Philippines. This group of islands, surrounded by the Pacific, the South China Sea, and the Sulu Sea, is characterized by a large variety of peoples and clans. The Dumagat live in the north, on the island of Luzon in the province of Aurora, close to the capital city of Manila. They live as half nomads and move their huts according to the seasons and/or the availability of food. It can take years for them to resettle a former village. In that way, they avoid over-exploitation of the resources the natural environment provides. While the men are busy hunting and foraging for food, the women build the dwellings. Gathering, hunting, fishing, and a bit of simple farming define the traditional lifestyle of this people group. A particularly important custom among the Dumagats is the fair distribution of the food the men have been able to bring home. All other daily work is also done together as much as possible. That strengthens the communal sense of belonging. For the children of the village, school primarily means the school of life. In order to survive in the wilderness, it is simply more important to be able to make a fire using primitive methods than knowing your ABCs. Plantains, or cooking bananas, are one of the children's favorite foods. They are a major nutritional staple in Asia as well as other parts of the world. The Ilongot people make their home in the southern Sierra Madre and Caraballo Mountains in the eastern part of the island of Luzon. They live mostly along rivers, using them as a source of food and transport routes. The rivers have taken the successful hunters and warriors to regions beyond their own habitat, and they have shared what they have seen and learned with their entire clan. That, for example, is how the Ilongot women have learned to use a wide variety of plants and herbs for food and medicine over the centuries. The women also take care of the rice harvest. They separate the valuable grain from the chaff using heavy wooden poles. If an Ilongot man is interested in a woman, he helps her with her day-to-day chores, looking for an opportunity to get close to her. This gentlemanly manner towards their women carries on through the rest of their lives together. The methods used to pass the traditions and values of the tribe, as well as other important knowledge on to the next generation, are very similar to those of the Dumagats. The lessons are most often given in the form of exciting stories. The peaceful family life doesn't seem to fit into the gruesome history of the headhunting tribe of the Ilongots. Until the arrival of the Spanish conquistadores, headhunting was common practice among the tribes of the Philippines. The Ilongots tribe in particular was notorious for its brutal dealings with its enemies all the way up until the 1970s. Taking the heads served to demoralize the enemy. The severed head was rolled around on the ground and reviled and insulted. A man had to have been successful in headhunting in order to be allowed to wear the headdress of the rhinoceros bird. Music is an important part not only of tribal rituals and festivals. The Ilongot dance to all of life situations, from weddings to funerals and to wars. The tagim, a dance performed after the hunt, shows how aggressively the Ilongot handle their weapons to this day. The women, on the other hand, give the round dance a grace and gentleness one would not anticipate from this former headhunting people. They make music using traditional instruments like the bamboo guitar or zither, the bamboo fiddle, and the flute. The spoils of the hunt are distributed in the same manner as with the Dumagat. The entire village is supplied. Here, a slaughtered wild pig is distributed in equal portions. In very few places on Earth are the contrasts between primitive indigenous peoples and the civilized world as stark as they are in the Philippines. And even though the majority of the population is Christian, in fact, the practice of their faith has become a mixture of Christian ritual and cultic customs and traditions. Some customs go to extremes that Western observers can hardly fathom. For example, during the procession on Good Friday, the faithful carry their iconic statues through the streets of the city, as is the case in many other countries of the world. But here, following the statues, a large number of men march in the procession, inflicting wounds on their own backs with whips. The self-flagellators use whips tipped with sharp bits of wood to inflict the greatest amount of pain. In addition, The skin is slit open with razor blades to ensure that blood flows freely in this act of penance. Festivities reach their climax on Good Friday with a grand procession in almost all larger towns in the Philippines. In some places, the self-punishment is the more harmless part of the event. This self-punishment, by the way, is an attempt to share in the suffering of Christ on his way to the crucifixion. Inflicting pain on oneself or taking on a burden of suffering is common in many religions and, interestingly enough, falls nearly exclusively on the men. It gets pretty bad for the more extreme among the sacrificial men. In many towns, the crucifixion is celebrated as a grand spectacle. Volunteers let themselves be physically nailed to the cross with real nails. The Catholic Church does not support such activities during the Easter week because the rituals are permeated with heathen elements, and people obviously find significant levels of voyeuristic pleasure in them. But perhaps the church leaders in Rome need to be a bit more tolerant of regional customs. Many of the Philippine believers take their religion and their local rites and rituals very seriously. A similar mixture of Christianity introduced by Spanish colonial expansion and local heathen customs is found in Middle and South America. Besides Catholicism, Indian customs still play an important role to this day. That is particularly true for the few indigenous people who still hang on to a relatively traditional lifestyle. We visited the Coco Indians, among others. Only a few tribes of the nearly extinct people live such a Spartan life in their straw huts. Here too, plantains are one of their favorite foods, especially for the children. Song and dance are one of their great pleasures, which also promotes interaction between the men and the women. As primitive as the huts may seem to the observer, dramatic changes are taking place in the families living in them. It is not unusual for the well-trained and educated children, who have been living in the cities for a long time already, to visit their parents who have no work qualifications whatsoever and still eke out an impoverished and simple existence off the land. If there is a common thread between the generations, it is in the realm of spiritual practices in the area of faith and therapy, in shamanism. In many natural religions, shamans, or medicine men, are attributed the ability through their ecstatic rituals to delve into areas of consciousness unreachable by normal people. The spiritual understanding of such gifted individuals varies considerably from one shaman to another. Shamanism has accompanied humanity longer than any of today's established world religions. Some say that its origins can be traced back to over 500,000 years ago. When a medicine man looks for certain plants and herbs, he is not necessarily looking for medicinal plants to cure the patient's illness. He is rather looking for substances which will enable him to treat the patient in a hallucinogenic state. This gives him access to the metaphysical regions in which he can play his part as mediator between the physical and the spiritual worlds. Not all shamans use drugs to accomplish their tasks. Some dance or sing themselves into an ecstatic state. The treatment ritual itself often has a hypnotic effect on the patient. Here, in this recreated scene, the altered state of both parties is used to cure the shaman's daughter of an excruciating headache. The powers of the dark world not only give his saliva pain-removing properties, but also help to shield the body from the evil, pain-causing spirits. The mixture of customs and traditions reaches from traditional dress to how festivals are celebrated. The forced missionizing by the Spaniards left South America with a definitive European flair in the architecture of many cities. Like here in Quito, for example, the capital city of Ecuador. To this day, the blatant contrast between the extensive poverty of the population and the immeasurable wealth lavished on the Christian church buildings remains. The Church of St. Francisco is an impressive example. Could it really be okay with the Christian God that his church shines in such overabundance at the cost of his followers? Many of the artworks depict the unimaginable suffering of the people under colonial rule. They don't depict any Spanish tormentors, however, but rather blame the devil for what happened. Against the backdrop of such insincerity on the part of the religion brought in by the Spaniards, it is difficult for the observer to understand why the local people would attribute a major Christian figure, the Virgin of Grace, with sparing their city of Latacunga during the eruption of the Cotopaxi volcano in the 17th century. The Virgin of Grace was renamed the Black Mama, or La Mama Negra, due to the influence of black slaves. And when Christian and heathen characters are combined during the grand festival honoring La Mama Negra, it is just another indication that for many people, it is perhaps not so important which god one believes in. It seems to be more important to most that people with the broad range of character traits typical to man find a common identity in the customs and traditions growing out of the various religions. Singing and dancing together strengthens bonds and promotes peace within a society. That is the same all over the world. It might be good for important world leaders to spend less time sitting around conference tables and more time in joyful song and dance with each other.